بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أهلا وسهلا ومرحبا بكم. Welcome to all of you, inshallah, to another tafsir class, inshallah, in this month. Yesterday we covered the first part of Surah Al-Imran, which focused on the clarification of the misguidance of the Christians in particular, and it addressed a lot of their doubts and advised them. Today, inshallah, I'm going to talk about the second part of the surah, and this surah is mainly consists of two parts. The first part being about the Christians, like we mentioned. And the second part is about the Battle of Uhud. The Battle of Uhud and the lessons that we can take from it. And it's more addressed to us, Ummat al-Islam. طيب. Okay. And in essence, the second part of the Ummah, the second part of the Surah, just like Surah Al-Baqarah. Surah Al-Baqarah, the first part was about the Jews, and then the second part was addressed to us. And why we as Ummah al-Islam, inshallah, are different, why Allah has chosen us, why Allah has given us that superiority that He has, and warning us against falling into what they fell into, such that it doesn't befall us what befell them. So in that regard, the second part of the surah, after talking about it talks about the Kaaba, and again it talks about Ibrahim alayhi salam, just like Surah Al-Baqarah, when the conversation turned from the Jews to us, it went through and talked about the Qibla first and the Kaaba and the importance of it. Same thing applies here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that إِنَّ أَوَّلَ بَيْتٍ وضع للناس للذي ببكة مباركة وهدى للعالمين. At the first house that has been built for the people, yes, يعني for them to worship Allah, للذي ببكة is the one in بكة, and بكة is one of the names of مكة. مباركة, blessed it is, وهدى للعالمين. فيه آيات بينات, Allah mentions in it there are clear signs. From it مقام إبراهيم. Maqam Ibrahim, which are those stones that Ibrahim alayhi salam, you know, where he stood on, and then this guy's footprint on it. And until this day and age, it's still there. And a lot of you, those of you that have done Umrah or Hajj, must have seen it, the Maqam Ibrahim. You can still see the footprints. Okay? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us of falling into the mistakes of those before us. Allah says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن تُطِيعُوا فَرِيقًا مِنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ يَرُدُّوكُمْ بَعْدَ إِيمَانِكُمْ كَافِرِينَ. That, oh, you who believe, if you were to obey a group from those, from the people of the book, then indeed they would return you back to kufr and disbelief after you have entered into iman. Warning us not to obey them, especially when it comes to religious matters. We don't refer back to them when it comes to religious matters, and we don't obey them. We don't seek religious advice from them. Okay? Because indeed, if we did, then they would return us back to kufr. And Allah mentions another ayah that how can someone that is misguided guide you? It's not possible. Yes? Tayyib. That's why the people in Hellfire, they will say, لو هدانا الله لهديناكم. That when the followers of misguided figureheads, they blame them in hellfire, then what will these figureheads say? They will say, لو هدانا الله لهديناكم. Indeed, if Allah had guided us, we would have guided you. Okay? So, don't seek guidance from someone or from a source that you know is misguided or upon misguidance. Okay? If it comes to worldly affairs, that's a different story. Technology, innovation in technology and these sort of things, that's a different story. But when it comes to religious advice and how we should live our lives, and what's morally correct, and what's ethical and not ethical, and what's right and what's wrong, they will don't return back except to the Quran and the Sunnah and that which we have from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as Muslims don't accept to be lectured by those that have left the revelation of Allah. We don't accept to be lectured by them when it comes to the things that please Allah or the things that are good or that are bad. Never. And Allah tells us here that if you were to obey them and we were to do that, then indeed they will turn us back to kufr. Okay? Advice to all Muslims. Tayyib. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest mistake that those before us have fell into is their differing in their religion. Okay? The innovations that they fell into. Their change of Allah's religion. Okay? If we look at Christianity today, it's nothing but innovations. Things Allah hasn't sent down. We look at Judaism today, it's nothing but innovations. They have changed their religion. Okay? They have not upheld their book that Allah sent to them. They have adulterated that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to them. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us advice and telling us that we shouldn't fall into the same trap. And he says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. All of you, hold on to the rope of Allah. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not differ. What is the rope of Allah? The rope of Allah is the revelation from Allah. The Quran and the Sunnah. Both of them. That's why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, صَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِي أَبَدًا. That I've left with you two things. If you hold on to it, you will never go astray after me. كِتَابُ اللَّهِ وَسُنَّتِي. The book of Allah and my Sunnah. This is the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is commanding us to hold on to it. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَضُّوا عَلَيْهَا بِالنَّوَاجِدْ. Bite onto it with your molar teeth. Because indeed, it's the greatest blessing that you have. It's something you bite onto with your molar teeth that the only way I'm going to let go is if I lose my molars. There's no other way. Because this, one of the strongest grips that we have as humans is our bite or our the strength in our jaw. So bite onto your molar teeth. Yani hold on to it to the best of your ability. Don't let go. And Allah says here, وَاعْتَصِمُوا. Hold on to the rope of Allah. Then Allah said, وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And do not split. Okay? So if we contemplate on this, dear brothers and sisters, what does splitting mean? What is splitting? What is differing? Okay? What's the source of all the different sects that the Muslim Ummah has split into? What is the cause for that? The cause for that is not holding on to the rope of Allah. So, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا on one side. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, the opposite. The opposite of holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by innovating into the religion. And that's what causes tafarruq. That's what causes splitting. Okay? So, dear brothers and sisters, splitting is not that one warns against innovations and that one calls out those that call to innovations. That's not splitting. That's not the cause of the split. That's just addressing the problem. The problem is, or the problem that caused the splitting are the innovations. Because we are all aware that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions, they were all united. They were all united. صح? Upon the Quran and the Sunnah. All the companions were united upon the Quran and the Sunnah. So when did splitting start? Splitting started when innovations were introduced into the religion. Okay? So if you like, the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one path. Is one path that everybody from amongst the companions were upon. Those that introduced innovations, they split away from the jama'ah. They split away from the main body. So tafarruq, if you come across in the Quran the word tafarruq, wala tafarruq, and do not split, it means do not innovate. And do not follow innovations. Because they are the cause of splitting of the ummah. So, how can the ummah be one body once again? How can the Ummah be united once again? Only one way. They can only be united upon the Quran and the Sunnah. They can only be united by holding on to the rope of Allah. Until every single faction from this Ummah and all those innovated sects, until they return back to the truth and they hold on to the rope of Allah, the Ummah will never be united. My dear brothers and sisters, the unity of the Ummah is not mere words that we say by our tongues, that we come together under one umbrella when our aqidahs are different and what we believe is different and the way we worship Allah is different. That's not unity. That's not unity. Unity is when we all have one source and we all stick to that one source and we all have one belief. We all act upon that one belief. That's the unity of the Ummah. Okay? So Allah says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا, all of you. Nobody is excluded from this. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and do not split. وَذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ, and remember the blessing of Allah upon you. إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. Allah says, remember the blessing of Allah upon you when you used to be enemies to each other, such as the Aus and the Khazraj from amongst the Ansar. They were arch enemies. Yes. And then Allah says, you were enemies, but then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He brought your hearts together. And with His blessing, you became brothers. Okay? So how did Allah bring their hearts together? How did their hearts come together? How did this unity come about? By way of them following the same aqidah and religion and uniting upon the same, uniting upon Islam and the Sunnah. Okay? That's how the hearts come together. And the number one thing that turns the Muslims' hearts away from each other and that makes them enemies to each other is bid'ah and innovation. That's what turns people and the Muslims away from each other. And that's what weakens the Ummah. Okay? So this surah and this ayah in particular is teaching us, yes, the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll come across many other ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of the blessing of sunnah, the blessing of following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, in Surah Al-Baqarah and this surah, my dear brothers and sisters, we appreciate the blessing of Islam and the blessing of sunnah. And Allah constantly reminds us in Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran, this great blessing. The same blessing we asked for in Surah Al-Fatiha. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Guide us to the straight path. This is the straight path. The rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kitabullah wa sunnati. The book of Allah and the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tayyib. Then Allah says, let there be from amongst you an ummah that calls to the khair and commands with the good and forbids the evil. And indeed, they are the successful ones. Okay, so commanding with the good and forbidding the evil, yes, in all of its forms. Okay, so commanding with tawheed and warning the people against shirk. And then a level lower than that, commanding the people with sticking to the sunnah and warning against innovations and bid'ah. And then the third level, commanding the people with obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and warning the people against major sins. Okay? These three levels, if you like. Yes? But unfortunately, what do we have this day and age? We have people that involve themselves in da'wah and that want to, if you like, come across as if they are callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their YouTube channels, everything. And the only thing, they start from the third level, they leave level one and level two. And this indeed, wallah, is khiyanah. This is khiyanah of the ummah. This is deceiving the ummah. When all of your lectures and everything you talk about is only about sins and good deeds and, you know, fada'il a'mal, and you talk about, you know, even major sins, yes, you warn against it, and you talk about, you know, dhikr and these sort of things. All of these things are important, yes? But when you start with the third level and there's no mention of the first level, there's no mention of the second level, wallahi, you are not, yes, from those that do Amr bil Ma'ruf, that command with the good and forbid from the evil. How can you leave off warning against the greatest of evils and then say, I warn against evil? Wallah, you can warn against, you can warn the Muslim Ummah against all of the major sins, yes, such as, or most of the great major sins other than shirk, such as, you know, stay away from drinking alcohol, stay away from zina and all these sort of things. You can warn the Ummah against it, yes. But if you don't warn them against shirk, then you have deceived them. Why? Because these major sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive that one associate partners with him and the shirk. وَيَغْفِرْ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ. But he forgives all the other sins for whoever he wants. So all the other sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala might forgive the Muslim for it on the Day of Judgment. And if Allah doesn't forgive him, he might be punished in the hellfire, but he will not be there for eternity. But whoever falls into shirk, then Allah says, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. That indeed who falls into shirk, then Allah has made Jannah haram for him. So you warning against all these other evils, but not warning against shirk, that people can see, that people are involved in, from amongst the Muslim ummah, then indeed you've deceived the Muslim ummah. And you're not a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? To command the people with all of the fadaila amal, yes, but not command them with tawheed and worshipping of Allah alone, you have deceived the ummah. And you're not one that calls to good. Okay? The second level, yes? To command the people with good, but not command them with sticking onto the sunnah, then you have not aided the ummah of Islam. Because the ill of this ummah lies in those two things. The greatest ills. Them falling into shirk or falling into bid'ah, innovations. So this, as a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as someone wants to rectify the ummah and that wants to, you know, if you like, aid his brothers and sisters in the pleasing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and going to Jannah, then for you not to address these two things, yes, then you indeed have deceived them, especially when that is what they are waiting from you. It's like a doctor, dear brothers and sisters, a doctor, a medical doctor, yes, who's presented with a patient, right? This patient, let's say he's got an acute illness, yes, that will kill him, right? And the doctor knows this and he's aware of this. But then he focuses on other cosmetic issues and he focuses on maybe some kind of problems he's got with his knees or his back when he's got cancer and he doesn't address it and allows it to spread. Yes? What would happen to that doctor? Yes? He would be taken to court. Right? Because this patient, he was relying on him and he was taking his advice. Same thing with those that have been entrusted with the da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they address these side issues, yes, issues that are side issues compared to tawheed and shirk. They are side issues compared to sunnah and bid'ah, as important as they are. Yes? If you do all of the good deeds that you can think of, yes, but you commit shirk, Allah won't accept any of it. All of them become side issues. Okay? Likewise, if you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala day and night, but not upon the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, none of it will be accepted. Allahu musta'an. So this surah, it tells us the superiority of this ummah and that we are the best of nations. And the ayah will come, inshallah, that talks about this in the coming few pages. And this is one of them as well. وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ. Let there be from you a group that call to khair. Okay? طيب. So holding on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to ourselves. Yes? And calling others to it. This is why this ummah has this high status. Yes? And this is why the religion of Islam, until today, there's still a group of people that are upon the sunnah. Yani, if the earlier generations did not implement this, if they did not hold on to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way they did, or if they did not warn against innovations the way that they did and fight it, yes, in order to preserve al-Islam, do you think, dear brothers and sisters, Islam would have reached us today in its correct form? La wallahi, we would have been like the Jews and the Christians, having nothing left in front of us other than a corrupt religion or corrupted religion. La. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the tawfiq to protect and look after this religion because Allah promised that He will preserve this religion on the Day of Judgment. And He has preserved it through them, the earlier generations and the scholars and those that protect the religion. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has foretold this in many different ahadith. Okay? So we need to keep up this legacy. Okay, how do we keep it up? By ourselves holding on to the rope of Allah, number one, the Quran and the Sunnah, and calling the people to it, and warning against everything that goes against it. طيب. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions then in the following page that we are the best of nations. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You're the best of nations Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought forth for the people. Best of nations. Why? تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهُونَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. Because you command with the good and you forbid the evil and you believe in Allah. Something that the Jews didn't do. Allah says about them in Surah Al-Ma'idah, كَانُوا لَا يَتَنَاهُونَ عَنْ مُنْكَرٍ فَعَلُوهُ. That they would not warn against the evils that they used to do amongst each other. They would not warn against the evils and the munkar. That's why their religions become corrupted. Same thing with the Christians before them. Yes? So here, Allah tells us, we're the best of nations brought forth for the people. Why? Because we command with the good and we forbid the evil. Okay? And don't expect, my dear brothers and sisters, that the people of innovation and those upon misguidance, yes, they will just stay quiet while you war against that evil. La wallahi. They'll wage war against you. They will character assassinate you. They will play the victim. Oh, why are you talking about us? We're your brother, Muslim brothers and sisters. You know, you are splitting the ummah. Don't do this. You know, let's unite upon that which we agree upon. Let's turn a blind eye to our disagreements. La wallah. La wallah. How are we going to turn a blind eye to shirk? How are we going to turn a blind eye to innovation? If we were to do that, we would have followed the path of the Jews and the Christians before us that Allah warned us against. If we were to do that, we would not have been the best of ummas. Rather, we won't. We will never turn a blind eye to it. We will command with the good, we'll forbid the evil. Those that accept it, those that love it, alhamdulillah. Those that don't accept it, mutu bighaydikum. And we do this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tayyib. Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. Again, these ayat, dear brothers and sisters, a whole lecture can be dedicated to it. But inshallah will suffice with that for now. We'll continue. And inshallah, maybe sometime in the future, inshallah, we can go into more detail. Tayyib, the best of nations. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us, once again, to be wary of our enemies. Yes? The inner enemy from amongst the munafiqun and the ones on the outside. Both of them we need to be aware of. Yes? Allah says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِّن دُونِكُمْ. Do not take as allies and friends, yes, those that are not upon iman. لَا يَأْلُونَكُمْ خَبَالًا. All they want for you is destruction. وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُمْ. Everything that harms you, they love it. قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِّنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ. Indeed, the hatred for you has become apparent through their tongues and through their mouths. وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُمْ أَكْبَرُ. And indeed, that which their hearts conceal is greater than that which they've said. يعني, their hatred for us, it's wadih. We can hear it. Yes? Their hatred for us. Their anti-Islam rhetoric. Yes? Their Islamophobia. It's apparent. We can see that. But Allah says to us, وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُمْ أَكْبَرُ. But no, that what that which is in their hearts, what they conceal in their hearts of hatred, it's greater than that which is apparent on their tongues. قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. Indeed, we've made clear to you the ayat and the verses and the signs if you are those تَعْقِلُونَ that comprehend and have aql. هَا أَنْتُمْ أُولَاءِ تُحِبُّونَهُمْ. Allah says, here you are and you love them. وَلَا يُحِبُّونَكُمْ. And they don't love you. When تُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْكِتَابِ كُلِّ. When in reality you believe in the entirety of the book. يعني, in other words, we believe everything that came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which means everything that came from Allah that's authentic and still correct that the Jews or the Christians have, we believe in it. Okay? We only disbelieve that which they have added and they have changed. But anything in their books as in accordance to what Allah has given us, we believe in it. Okay? And what did they do? They disbelieve in what we have, even though it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe in their prophets, they don't believe in ours. So how is it that we love them? Yes, and they don't love us. It should be the other way around. They should love us for believing in their prophets and believing in some of the part of their religion that's still intact. Yes, it shouldn't be the other way around. So Allah is saying, "Ha antum la tuhibbunhum wa la yuhibbunakum wa tu'minuna bil kitabi kullihi wa idha laqukum qalu amanna." And if they meet you, they say, "We believe." So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is, you know, talking about the Munafiqun. So this ayah It talks about both enemies. Those that make Islam apparent from amongst the munafiqun, but they hide kufr, or those that make kufr apparent. It doesn't make a difference. We should be aware of all of them. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن تَمْسَسْكُمْ حَسَنَةٌ تَسُؤُهُمْ. If good comes your way, it harms them. وَإِن تُصِبْكُمْ سَيِّئَةٌ يَفْرَحُوا بِهَا. And if harm comes your way, they're happy, they rejoice in it. وَإِن تَصْبِرُوا وَتَتَّقُوا لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ كَيْدُهُمْ شَيْئًا. But if you have patience and you have taqwa, then indeed their plots will not harm you. Okay? So we need to be aware of our enemies. Okay? And know, my dear brothers and sisters, that your enemy, our enemies, they come in different shapes and forms. Yes? They come in different shapes and forms. Some of them, yes, we can see from the outside they are enemies. They have a hatred for Islam. And some of them, dear brothers and sisters, they make apparent the love of Islam, but they destroy it from within. So we should be aware of that. We should be aware of that, especially in this day and age of YouTube and what have you. Yes? Wallahi, it might be that you watch a lecture, you think this person is called to Islam, when in essence, he is working to destroy Islam. So how do we know? How do we know? By studying the essence of Islam, learning what Islam is and what it stands for, then you will know those that are trying to destroy it. So those that are enemies to Tawheed, for example, yes, and they warn against Tawheed and the people that establish Tawheed, no matter what names they call, they can call it Wahhabi, they can say whatever they like, right? It doesn't matter, yes? The essence of Tawheed, worshipping Allah alone, those that can't stand this principle, they are the enemies of Islam, even if they have the greatest beard, yes? And they cry, and they recite the Quran in a way that, subhanAllah, that puts khushu' in your heart. Enemy of Islam. Likewise, those that fight the Sunnah. They fight the Sunnah. Yes? And they spread innovations. And they fight all of those that stand for the Sunnah and that are called to sticking to the Sunnah, following Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes? And they have an issue with it and they fight it. They are your enemy. Okay? So the enemies of Islam, they come in different shapes and forms. Right? So beware of it. Beware of your enemy. How do you know your enemy? By knowing Tawheed, knowing Sunnah, yes? And by way of that, you'll know those that are fighting. And you know, when the people of Shirk, yes, that ascribe themselves to Islam, those that worship graves and call upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go against the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they do go against Tawheed, they don't go against Tawheed and by name. They don't say we have an issue with La ilaha illallah. They don't say we have an issue with the kalimat Tawheed. La. But they change the meaning of Tawheed. For them, Tawheed means there's no creator but Allah. That's what they want you to think. When in essence, this is something the Quraysh agreed with. Okay? But they fight the real meaning of Tawheed, which is to worship Allah alone. So we as believers, and Allah teaches us in the Quran, we seen some ayat before in this regard, yes, we shouldn't be stuck to the words or the names. We should look at the meanings, the reality. Yes? Call it whatever you like. The worship of Allah alone. Yes? Ikhlas, Tawheed. Yes? This is what we stand for and this is what we protect. And anyone that calls to worshiping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it doesn't matter if he calls it wasila. And it doesn't matter what other name he calls it. Yes? In essence, he is going against the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so beware of that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Battle of Uhud. The Battle of Uhud. And the Battle of Uhud, dear brothers and sisters, we can't go into it in detail, but the gist of it is the second battle of Al-Islam after the Battle of Badr. As we know, the Battle of Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave victory to the believers and to the Muslims. But then in the Battle of Uhud, even though the Muslims and the believers at the upper hand, at the beginning, they got defeated. Right? Why did they get defeated? What do we learn from it? That will come up, inshallah. Right? So many lessons to be taken from the Battle of Uhud. Okay? So many lessons to be taken from all of the battles that Prophet Muhammad went through. Yes? And in particular, the Battle of Uhud. Because sometimes you learn more from your mistakes than you learn from the things you've done right. So we learn so much from the Battle of Uhud, in which the believers were defeated, so that we, as an ummah, don't repeat the same mistakes. Okay? And the companions, radiallahu anhum, they learned from the Battle of Uhud. And after the Battle of Uhud, it was victory afterwards. And they only went from strength to strength. Why? Because they took the lesson from Battle of Uhud. They learned the lesson. So when are we going to learn our lesson? So what's the Battle of Uhud? First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions an introduction to the battle. Okay? So the introduction of the battle, there are a few things. Number one, Allah reminds them of the Battle of Badr. Yes? And that Allah controls everything. And that victory only comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَقَدْ نَصَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ بِبَدْرٍ وَأَنْتُمْ أَذِلَّهُ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you victory and aided you in Badr, even though you are small in number. فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. So fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hope that you are thankful. Okay? Then Allah talks about how he has aided them with angels. Yes? And that he controls everything. وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضُ. Allah belongs everything in the heavens and the earth. Yes? Reminding them of his great blessings in Badr, and that they haven't won the Battle of Badr except through the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were a third in number compared to the Quraysh. Yes? So they haven't won because of being stronger in army or in that sense. La, they won because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving them victory. Okay? So Allah reminds them of that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the importance of obedience. So even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking here about battles and jihad, here Allah says, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا الرِّبَا ضَعَفًا مُضَاعَفًا. O you who believe, do not consume riba and usury. So one might ask, what's the connection between jihad and riba? What's the connection? The connection is obvious. Yes? Jihad or being given victory over your enemies is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah gives it to whoever he wants. Okay? So if you want that blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you need to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala necessitates staying away from those things that displeases him. And one of the greatest things that displeases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is usually a riba. Mortgages and what have you. Interest-based transactions. That's why in Surah Al-Baqarah, what did Allah say? فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. O you who believe, leave of usury and riba. And if you don't, then prepare for a war from Allah and His Messenger. How can Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give victory to a group of people who Allah threatened them with war? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. Prepare for a war from Allah and His Messenger. And you want Allah's victory? Huh? Involved in mortgages, usury, riba, not fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you say, why is the ummah so weak? Why is the ummah defeated? How do you get the victory of Allah and Allah's aid? When you are doing the things that Allah ta'ala cautioned you and said to you, you do this to prepare for war from Allah. And you want victory from Allah? That's the connection. That's why Allah mentioned this here. Even though Allah is talking about jihad, reminding them of a Badr, it's an introduction to the Battle of Uhud, but Allah reminds them. Stay away from usury. One example from the many different examples of the things we should stay away from. Okay? Then Allah continues in the following page. وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. Okay, if you've fallen into shortcomings, what is the solution? Then Allah says, hasten to the forgiveness of your Lord. And Jannah. Hasten to forgiveness from your Lord. Seek repentance. Okay? وَالَّذِينِ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهِ. Those that when they do a sin or they wrong themselves, they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. And they seek Allah's forgiveness. So as far as the previous sins are concerned, seek Allah's forgiveness. Make tawbah. And going forward, stay away from it. Okay? All of this an introduction to what? To jihad fi sabilillah and to gaining victory over our enemies. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then reminds them of the importance of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives the companions moral support. Don't fear death. And this world is nothing but a test. Allah says, إِن يَمْسَسْكُمْ قَرْحٌ فَقَدْ مَسَّ الْقَوْمَ قَرْحٌ مِثْلُهُ. If, you know, harm has come your way and you get defeated, right? Then they harm has come their way as well. You're not the only one that is feeling pain. You're not the only one that has endured losses. لا. And Allah says, وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ. And Allah says, that's how we alternate between victory and defeat amongst the people. Allah alternates between them. One day, the Muslims have victory. One day, their enemies have victory. And there's a great wisdom behind this. For indeed, if the Muslims were to be victorious at all times, what would happen? They would take victory for granted. Yes? They wouldn't submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be in that state of, you know, of submission to Allah, asking for His aid and victory if they take it for granted. Okay? So if victory came the way of the Muslims, life wouldn't be a test. And so many hypocrites would enter into Al-Islam just in search of that bounty and those worldly benefits. Yes? If victory lasted forever. And we can look at the history of the Ummah. When did the Ummah become weak? The Ummah became weak when dunya has entered upon the Ummah. The Ummah was the strongest, yes, at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions, when dunya was little. But when the Ummah had spread to the corners of the earth, that's when weakness entered upon the Ummah. That's when a lot of hypocrites entered into Al-Islam. And that's when the Muslims started to split. Okay, so if victory were to always be the case, then this would harm us as an Ummah. Rather, Allah teaches us a lesson here and there. So Allah alternates between victory and defeat. Okay, sometimes we're victorious, sometimes we're defeated. Okay, so that we constantly return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَتِلْكَ الْأَيَّامُ نُدَاوِلُهَا بَيْنَ النَّاسِ وَلِيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيَتَّخَذَ مِنْكُمْ شُهَدَاءَ. And so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may know and it can be clear for the people, yes, those that truly believe. And so that He can choose from amongst you those that He wants to give martyrdom to. وَيَتَّخِذَ مِنْكُمْ شُهَدَاء. Allah chooses martyrdom for whoever He wants. وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الظَّالِمِينَ. وَلِيمَحِصَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَيَمْحَقَ الْكَافِرِينَ. Allah mentions, and that Allah may test or purify the believers and destroy the disbelievers. So we have victory sometimes, so that Allah may destroy the disbelievers. And sometimes we're defeated, so Allah may test us and purify us from our sins. Okay? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, part of the moral support, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the worst thing that can happen to the Ummah al-Islam at that stage. The worst thing that could happen is that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is killed. That would have been the worst calamity that would befall upon the companions radiallahu anhum at that time. So Allah is telling them, even if this were to happen, yes? وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُولُ. Then Muhammad is nothing but a messenger, and before him many messengers have come and gone. أَفَإِن مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ. Is it that if he dies or if he's killed that you will return back to kufr? No, that's not the case. وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْءٍ. And indeed, whoever returns back to kufr, then he will not harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the least. وَسَيَجْزِ اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Allah will reward those that are thankful. Okay? And we all know that this ayah, subhanAllah, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he passed away, and the companions found it hard to accept, and Umar radiallahu anhu especially, yes, found it hard to accept Abu Bakr. Allah showed the virtue of Abu Bakr. He stood up and he said to them that whoever worshipped Muhammad, then Muhammad has indeed died. But whoever worshipped Allah, then Allah is Hayy. Allah is the ever living. And then he recited this ayah, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِن مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ. And then the companions and Umar said that it's as if this verse wasn't revealed until now. Before that, the verse, they would recite it, they would read it, but they wouldn't really realize the effect of this verse. So it's as if Umar, first time he heard this verse in his life, because now it's reality. Okay? Before this, it was, what if? Now it's reality. Prophet ﷺ died, and now this verse became relevant to them. And طبعا they implemented it, radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So Allah is telling them, what's the worst that can happen? This is the worst that can happen. But even if this were to happen, still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is al-hayy, He is al-qayyum. And Muhammad ﷺ is a messenger, yes? And he was never meant to stay with us forever, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah ta'ala sent him to deliver the message. After he delivered the message, Allah took him back. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala join us with him in Jannat al-Firdaus. us and all of our loved ones. طيب. So that's the worst. And so Allah Ta'ala again morally preparing the companions radiallahu anhum. Yes. And giving them advice. طيب. So Allah then, after that, Allah gives us some good examples. وَكَأَيِّ مِن نَبِيٍ قَاتَلَ مَعَهُ رِبِّيُّونَ كَثِيرًا. Allah mentions, and how many prophets before, yes, have fought in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and with them, you know, a lot of their followers fought with them. فَمَا وَهَنُوا لِمَا أَصَابَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلٍ. They were not weakened by that which has struck them or has befell them in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا ضَعُفُوا. They didn't become weak. And they didn't submit. And Allah loves those that are patient. وَمَا كَانَ قَوْلَهُمْ. And all they said is, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا. Oh Allah, forgive us our sins. وَإِسْرَافَنَا فِي أَمْرِنَا. And our going beyond bounds. Yes? وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا. And make our feet firm. Oh Allah. وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. Aid us against the people that disbelieve. فَآتَاهُمُ اللَّهُ ثَوَابَ الدُّنْيَا. So Allah gave them the reward in this world, i.e. victory, وَحُسْنَ ثَوَابِ الْآخِرَةِ, and the great reward in the hereafter. وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. طيب, again, Allah giving this moral support to the companions رضي الله عنهم before the battle of Uhud. Then, obviously, the battle of Uhud commenced, happened, and the companions got defeated رضي الله عنهم. Yes, after they had the upper hand. And there's a lot of lessons to be taken from that. A lot of lessons. The first lesson really is obedience, obedience, obedience to Allah and His Messenger. Because the reason why the companions got defeated is because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed a group of them, a group of the companions, to stay on the hill and not to come down, no matter what happens. Yes, he said, until we come to you, do not come down. It doesn't matter, even if the birds start eating us, right? Yani if we're all dead, yes, stay there. Or if you're victorious, you stay there. It doesn't matter. Stay there. Then obviously what happened is, after the Muslims had the upper hand and these companions, radiallahu anhum, they thought, khalas, the battle is over, they descended. And even though their leader said to them, don't. This is Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he advised them. But no. Allah says, minkum man yuridu dunya wa minkum man yuridu al-akhirah. Some of you want some of the life of this world and some of you want the akhirah. Okay? So a bit of this, you know, weakness happened. Okay, so after they did that, obviously the Kuffar and the Quraysh, they basically took advantage of that, and the Muslims, they were attacked from behind, and what happened. And what do we learn from this? The importance of obeying the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If this small group of companions that disobeyed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if the result of it was the defeat in the battle of Uhud and so many companions being martyred, yes, then what does that teach us as an ummah? And they disobeyed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam on one thing only. How about us that disobeyed the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in so many different things, and we disobey him sometimes in the most fundamental things in our religion, tawheed and shirk and major sins? Huh? What consequences that have on the ummah? Did we think of that? طيب. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the forgiveness and how He has forgiven them, those companions. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَلَّوْا مِنْكُمْ يَوْمَ الْتَقَى الْجَمْعَانِ. That those of you that turned away on that day. إِنَّمَا اسْتَزَلَّهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ بَعْدَ مَا كَسَبُوا. Yani after the companions were defeated, or after the kuffar came from the back, they fled. Yes, and some of them, they turned away. Most of them, they turned away out of fear. طبعاً. And we all know that it's impermissible, it's from the major sins to flee from the battlefield. But Allah says, you know, the shaitan made them slip. And Allah says, وَلَقَدْ عَفَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ. Indeed, Allah has forgiven them. Allah has forgiven them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ حَلِيمٌ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He teaches us an important lesson, which is not to dwell on the past. Allah says, oh, you who believe, يَا لَذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Do not be like the disbelievers. What did they do? وقالوا لإخوانهم إذا ضربوا في الأرض أو كانوا غزا لو كانوا عندنا ما ماتوا وما قتلوا. They say that when they go to fight, yes, when they go to fight battles, yes, and some of them get killed, they say that indeed, if they were with us and they didn't go out to fight, they wouldn't have been killed. That's what the disbelievers, they believe. They don't have the belief in Qadr. They don't believe that. They don't believe that death will come to you no matter where you are. Okay? Allah is telling us, don't be like them. What happened, happened. Those that died, they died because their death was written. Okay? Regardless if you went out to the Battle of Uhud or not. Okay, so why shouldn't we dwell on the past? Allah says, لِيَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ ذَلِكَ حَسْرَةً فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. Why do the disbelievers have this feeling? And what is its consequences? What is its effect? Allah says that this shortcoming in the aqidah and them not believing that to Allah belongs everything, that everything is pre-decreed, Allah says Allah makes this as a source of hasra and grief in their heart. Okay? Because, you know, and this happens, and we find this, you know, in the West especially, you know, when something unfortunate happens, yes, the kuffar and disbelievers, they will not have rest in their hearts and they will never feel good, yes, until they can put the blame on someone or something, even if it be themselves, right? Okay, and they'd be like, oh, if this happened, this wouldn't happen. If that happened, that wouldn't happen. And they dwell on it for way too much, yes, and it makes them lose their sleep over it. What if I hadn't done this, the person would be still alive. And they keep on blaming themselves for it. And this has a very negative effect on the person's mental health. Allah is telling us, don't be like the disbelievers. If a calamity befalls you, yes, then if it's because of a mistake that you made, seek repentance from it, yes, and learn a lesson from it. But don't say things like, oh, if that happened, this wouldn't have happened, this person's fault, that person's fault, because this is nothing from them, from the shaitan, and this will only harm you, okay, if you dwell on the past. طيب. يَجْعَلَ اللَّهُ ذَلِكَ حَسْرَةً فِي قُلُوبِ وَاللَّهُ يُحْيِي وَيُمِيتُ. And Allah is the one that gives life and death. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that when it comes to jihad, generally speaking, right, or the defending of our lives, and when it comes to, you know, these kind of battles, Allah says, وَلَئِنْ قُتِلْتُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَوْ مُتْتُمْ لَمَغْفِرَةٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَحْمَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. That indeed, if you are killed for the sake of Allah, or in the way of Allah, or you die, then the forgiveness of Allah and His mercy then is better than everything in this world. So it's all about the hereafter. It's not about the life in this world, dear brothers and sisters. Okay, because وَلَئِن مُتْتُمْ أَوْ قُتِلْتُمْ, Allah says, لِلَاللَّهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. That regardless, if you die or you're killed, you're still going to return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What do we learn from this? We learn from this that the Muslim ummah has many problems. Yes, some problems are religious problems. Yes, and some problems are worldly problems. Okay, so religious problems such as misguidance, shirk, bid'ah, sinning, these sort of things that will harm them in the hereafter. A lot of Muslims, they have these problems. And a lot of Muslims, you know, their problems, they might be guided or they might not have that problem, but they have got worldly problems. Poverty, if you like, you know, not having safety in the country they live in, or living in places of violence and war and these sort of things. No safety and security, right? Or no access to healthcare. All these are worldly problems, okay? If we compare the two, which of the two is worse? Okay? Allah says, وَلَئِن قُتِلْتُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَوْ مُتْتُمْ. If you're killed in the way of Allah, or you die, then the forgiveness of Allah and His mercy is greater than everything in this world. So at the end of the day, we're all going to die, yes? But out of these two problems that the Muslim ummah has, the problem that is far greater and far more harmful are the religious problems. Okay? Okay? So the pain that we feel, yes, when we look at a Muslim brother or sister that is falling into shirk or falling into innovation, wallah, is greater than the pain that we feel that when we look at a Muslim brother who's got nothing to eat. Wallah, true. Wallah. Okay? Yani if we have yaqeen and we have the certainty in the day of judgment, yes, and we see a Muslim, even though he looks apparently dunya-wise, he's got a big house, he's got a nice car, everything, yes, but we look at him and he's upon shirk. And he doesn't even know it. He's upon innovation, doesn't even know it. He doesn't pray his salah. Wallahi, the pain we feel for them wallah, is far greater than the pain we feel for our Muslim brothers and sisters who got nothing to eat. Why? Because Allah mentions here that if they die or they're killed for the sake of Allah, then the forgiveness of Allah and His mercy is greater than everything in this world. Okay? This dunya is worth nothing. It's the hereafter that matters. Okay? So again, the victory that this ummah needs, yes? The victory they need against, or the aid that they need against shaitan and their own selves, yes? And the shirk and the bid'ah that is widespread and the sinning, us aiding them and helping the Muslim ummah against overcoming those struggles, wallah, it's far greater than helping them overcome the struggles of this world. And not that I'm dismissing the importance of feeding a Muslim. Not that I'm dismissing the importance of aiding our Muslim brothers and sisters financially. Absolutely important. Yes? But wallah is not more important than aiding them spiritually. Yes? It's not important, more important than that. That you gift to someone the gift of guidance through by the permission of Allah, and that you teach him tawheed, wallah is far greater, yes, than that you pay for his bills for the rest of his life. Wallah. Do both of them if you can. But where is the problem? The problem lies when we have individuals, yes, that the only thing they want to focus on, yes, is the ills of this world that the Muslim ummah goes through, but they want to completely overlook all of the ills and the problems they might have in the hereafter. So they don't address shirk, they don't address bid'ah, they don't address these issues that the Muslim ummah has, yes, but 24/7 they're fundraising for, you know, the other things. Do both of them. Both of them are important, yes? But do not overlook the one that is more important. Do not overlook the one that is more important. So that we cultivate ourselves first and foremost, and our families, and our Muslim brothers and sisters upon Tawheed and Sunnah is a far greater service to them and to the Ummah, yes? Than everything else. And for you to realize exactly what is meant by this, yes, look no further than the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Look no further than Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What did the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam bring forth to the companions radiallahu anhum in Mecca? And before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the dunya for the companions towards the end of the Prophet's life, yani, what did he give them? He gave them guidance. He connected them back with their Lord. He guided them to Tawheed with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? This is the greatest blessing. Yes, at times a companion would come to the Prophet and ask for money. And ask, and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wouldn't have it. And he would turn them away. Because he doesn't have it. Okay? So, again, Allah says that if that you die for the sake of Allah, if you're killed for the sake of Allah, you know, by your enemies, or you die, yes, then know that your hereafter is more important than your dunya. Okay? So truly, those that care about the Muslim ummah, they are those that cultivate the Muslim ummah upon Tawheed and Sunnah. They are the ones that care about the Muslim ummah, and not the ones that shout at the top of their heads and that cry and that get all emotional, yes, while they turn a blind eye to what's awaiting a lot of us in the hereafter, not even knowing. A lot of Muslims not even knowing they're falling into shirk, not even knowing they're falling into innovation, thinking they're pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by calling upon the dead in their graves. How can you turn a blind eye to that and then claim that he's your Muslim brother and that you love him? How? Wallahi, this is khiyana. And we mentioned this before. Tayyib. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the importance of mutual counsel. Allah says, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَمْ فَضُّوا مِّنْ حَوْلِكَ. Allah is saying to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you are harsh with your companions, they would have run away from you. So how about us? Okay, the scholars, they mention that indeed the truth is already heavy. Accepting the truth is something difficult and heavy. Don't make it even heavier with your bad akhlaq and your harshness. Prophet sallam said that indeed, you know, rifq, yes, and you know, being, you know, very lenient and rifq in the way that you are, being very soft in the way you bring across things, you know, it only increases in beauty. And harshness only makes things more ugly and more difficult to accept. So Allah is saying, وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّ مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. هذا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, and these are the companions. Allah is showing us the importance of calling to the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with hikmah and with sabr and with good akhlaq. طيب. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنْ يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ. That victory only comes from Allah. Indeed, if Allah aids you, then nobody will overcome you. You have to have yaqeen in this, my dear brothers and sisters. As an ummah, we have to have yaqeen in this. That if Allah aids us and gives us victory, no one will overcome us. وَإِنْ يَخْذُلْكُمْ. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forsakes us, huh? Who will help us after him? مَنْ الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ. No one. So, based on this, right, there are two questions. Number one, what should be our number one objective? Our number one objective should be to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because if Allah aids us, He's pleased with us and He aids us, no one will overcome us. And if He forsakes us, because He's not pleased with us, then nobody will aid us. So our number one objective should be to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next question, how can we achieve that? How can we gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by implementing His religion? And the first, foremost, tawheed. Okay? So again, where does the key to all the solution of this ummah lie? It lies in tawheed. Because through tawheed, we will please Allah. Allah is pleased with us, nobody will overcome us. Allah is displeased with us, Allah forsakes us, nobody will aid us. طيب. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the blessing of the sunnah. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has showed His favors to the believers, and He's been good to them. How? إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. When He has sent amongst them a prophet from amongst themselves. What does this prophet do? يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ. He recites to them His verses, يعني Allah's verses. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and He purifies them. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ, and He teaches them the book and the hikmah, which is the sunnah. وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Even though before that they were upon clear misguidance. Allah has been good to us, my dear brothers and sisters. لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And this is the greatest of blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The greatest blessing that the ummah has ever received is the sending of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to us so that he can teach us and he can recite the Quran to us and he can teach us the sunnah. The greatest blessing. The blessing of the sunnah. There's no greater blessing than this. The blessing of Islam and sunnah. Allahu Akbar. And Allah reminding us here that this is the greatest blessing that we've ever achieved. So hold on to it and be thankful for it. Tayyib. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that whatever happened to the companions in the Battle of Uhud, Allah says, is it that when a calamity befalls you, when indeed you have struck your enemy with a calamity that is twofold, yes, in the Battle of Badr, you've inflicted more of a loss to your enemies on the day of Badr. And then when calamity befalls upon you, you say, قُلْتُمْ أَنَّ هَذَا. How is this? Where did this come from? What happened? Allah says, قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. It is from yourselves. It's from your own sins. It's from you. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. طيب. So it's all because of our sins. You want solution? Return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the status of the companions and how they redeemed themselves for us to learn from. Yes, the companions, they disobeyed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of them did on the day of Uhud. Yes, the companions, when the Quraysh, they started attacking them from behind, they fled from the battle. They ran away. Yes, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, only a handful of companions were left with him. Okay? But what happened? They redeemed themselves. They came back. الَّذِينَ اسْتَجَابُوا لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا أَصْحَابَهُمُ الْقَرَحِ. Those that responded to Allah and His Messenger after wounds and after they were inflicted. أَصَابَهُمُ الْقَرَحِ. يعني they were wounded, tired, thirsty, you name it. Yes, but still, when the Prophet told them to come back, they redeemed themselves, they came back. Okay, so we need to pay attention to this. You slip, okay, we all slip, but get back up. Don't remain lying down, don't remain seated. You make a mistake, redeem yourself. The companions, radiallahu anhum, they redeemed themselves. Yes, they slipped, but they redeemed themselves straight away. And they were ready to continue fighting. Taib. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the test, or this test in this world, or sometimes when Allah tests us, it doesn't last forever. مَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيَذَرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَى مَا أَنْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ حَتَّى يَمِيزَ الْخَبِيثَ مِنَ الطَّيِّبِ. The test will only last for as long as is needed for the good, or the good ones to be separated from the evil ones, or the good to be a tayyib, the good to be separated from the khabith. That's how long the test will last. So when they're separated and the truthful one has become clear and the liar has been exposed, then the test will come to an end. That's how long it will last. So all the tests that the companions went through and the defeats that they went through, it didn't last forever. وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. The end result are for those that have taqwa. All we need to do is be patient. Be patient. Be patient and continue upon the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and know that the test will not last forever. طيب. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He concludes, and there was some speech about Ahl al-Kitab as well before that we have jumped, but before we get to the conclusion of the surah, there's one other ayah where Allah says that every soul shall taste death. كل نفس ذائقة الموت. We're all going to die. And Allah called this in another surah, Allah refers to death as al-yaqeen, the certainty. وَعَبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. And worship your Lord until death comes to you. But Allah called death al-yaqeen, certainty. Because wallahi, there's nothing more certain in this world than death. There's nothing more certain in this world than death. That's why, subhanAllah, when we hear about Jannah being eternal, Nar being eternal, it's difficult for us to imagine. I personally, the most difficult thing I try to imagine, yes, and I accept it, طبعاً we all accept it to be true, but something we can't imagine is that something is eternal and something will never come to an end. Why? Because from the day that we were born until the day we die, everything that starts has an end. There is nothing that will last. If there's one thing we're certain about in life, is that everything has an end. Okay? So every soul shall taste death. When? Allah knows best. Now, today, tomorrow, day after, 10 years, 100 years, it doesn't matter. Okay, there's a famous saying that says, كُلُّ آتٍ فَهُوَ قَرِيبٍ. Anything that is bound to come, then it's close. It's just a matter of time. We're all going to taste death. Okay, so what's the solution? So if we're all going to taste death, then what? وَإِنَّمَا تُوَفَّوْنَ أُجُورَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. You will be rewarded. You will get your reward on the day of judgment. Not in this world. يعني necessarily. So, death will come. Be patient. Continue being steadfast. And know that your reward won't go to waste. فَمَنْ زُحْزِحَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةَ فَقَدْ فَازَ. Whoever is saved from hellfire and entered into Jannah, then he's a successful one. This is what we call success. This is the definition of success. What is success? To be saved from hellfire, enter into Jannah. That's it. That's our objective in life. Nothing else. How can we save ourselves from hellfire? قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارَ. Allah says, O you who believe, save yourselves and your families from the hellfire. And how can we go to Jannah? Allah says, whoever is removed from the hellfire, saved from the hellfire, entered into Jannah, فَقَدْ فَازْ. He is a successful one. As far as this world is concerned, وَمَا الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَتَاعُ الْغُرُورِ. This world is nothing but an enjoyment. Delusional enjoyment. Nothing else. Nothing but an oasis. Nothing else. It won't last. Okay? So this is the advice. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. Yes? After talking about the Battle of Uhud, end of the day, all the lessons that we've mentioned that we're going to take, don't forget this lesson, which is death will come, and make sure you don't forget what your objective in life is, which is to enter into Jannah and be saved from hellfire. Okay? Continue working and don't give up. Inshallah, tomorrow we will conclude this surah and talk about the conclusion of the surah, in which there is an important dua, just like the way Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah concluded it with a dua. Likewise, this surah Al-Imran is concluded with a dua from the believers. We learn from it. We make this dua. The Prophet Muhammad used to make this dua regularly. And he used to recite these ayat regularly every night. Okay? Just the way that we recite the last two ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah as well. What are these ayat? What did they ask for? What is the dua? Inshallah, all of that we will cover tomorrow. هذا والله أعلم. صلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.